This podcast was recorded, edited, mixed, and produced at The Dream, a recording studio in South Austin, Texas. Visit thedreamrecordingstudio.com.
Welcome to episode 4. Who's popping in the zone? I'm one of your hosts, KG. I'm here, as always, with Kiran. What's up, Kiran?
Nothing much. Happy to be here.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
It has been a long time since episode 3.
Yeah, like 2 years, you said?
About like two years. Yeah, it feels really good to be back in the studio. Hogue, main man. Yeah.
What's up, fellas?
What's up?
You had a question about the song?
Yeah, who was that?
That was Primus.
Let's go.
John the Fisherman.
Why'd you pick that song?
Because it's fucking awesome.
No doubt.
Because the whole album, Frizzle Fry, is amazing. And I listen to it sometimes. Mm. But I'm not listening to Two Player recently. I've been listening to Primus.
Oh, yeah. Two Player's album's real good.
Hogue, that album, seriously, I love that album.
Thanks. You really do?
I really actually do. You want to know my favorite line from that album right now?
Hit me.
I can't believe they didn't charge me.
Can't believe they didn't charge me.
I don't know why. From I Built a Robot.
I think picking up the robot part.
Yeah. Can't believe they didn't charge me. Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, so we're back, man. We got episode 4. If you're watching this on the YouTube, you can see we've got no guest for this one. And that's okay because...
We ran out of money.
And we are the show anyway. They're lucky to be here when they're here.
Yeah.
No, actually, we have some things we want to clarify and just some things to clear up, some corrections to make from episodes 1, 2, and 3 that we would never have time to do if we had a guest here, because every episode is about 2.5 to 3 hours long.
Yeah, we're sorry.
Yeah. But that's why we gave such a long break, just to give people a chance to actually have the time to catch up on those first 3 episodes.
Yeah, hopefully you finished. You had enough time to do that. But yeah, episode 4. We're looking here. Forward to it. We also want to try to capture some of what Double Wide's history.
Absolutely.
Record that and make it permanent.
Yeah, a little historical context for Double Wide. Now that Double Wide is in its 20th season, the year now is 2021. It started in 2001. And there's some swag. There could be some 20-year anniversary swag coming out. I'll send out a link. I've talked to Chase Cunningham, one of the Double Wide captains, about it. They've got some cool gear for themselves, but they're going to offer up some stuff to alumni and probably just the whoever wants to buy it for a little fundraiser for some young dubs that could use some of the money to help them get to some of these tournaments. So be on the lookout for that. Anything new going on with you? You told me you couldn't do... Who's popping in the zone anymore? Do you remember why you told me that?
No.
Because you got Invisalign.
Oh, you're calling me out for that shit right now?
Yeah.
I was trying to hide behind the mic so nobody could see my Invisalign. Yeah, America. I'm trying to make myself better. I think everybody should do that. That's where I'm at in life right now.
I was surprised that you got it.
Yeah.
I'm not going to talk about it too much.
Yeah, okay.
But I thought this would be a great time to talk about it. You and Tank would be like the two people that it would surprise me most that would need to do anything to their smile. Because you have a fantastic smile.
Wow.
You know, like Tank, if Tank was like, I'm getting Invisalign, you'd be like, why? Your teeth are amazing. I was just surprised. Like my teeth, I could use some, like after I watched the first episode, you know how you get a little self-conscious about seeing yourself on the
screen? I think that was part of
screen.
It.
Really?
Yeah. This has been like, it's been good for me and really bad for me. Like, and I wish you would have talked to me before I spent $5,000 on this. All our sponsorship money.
Just going into your teeth right now.
Yeah. So, it's a good segue. Please sponsor us. Sponsor my man. Sponsor my teeth.
Yeah. Well, they're going to look great. I'm happy for you. I was noticing, you know, I drink coffee every day.
Yeah.
Right. My teeth are not the whitest. So I was like, after that first episode, I was like, I need a new laugh that doesn't include teeth. So I was like, But you're all right. You're comfortable with it now.
You're good. My laughing? No, you're showing my teeth?
Your teeth, because you're like, we can't do it anymore. But here we are.
No, I'm pretty uncomfortable right now.
You're keeping the mic right there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, America.
We didn't talk about this before. I did put you on spot. I'm sorry about that. I might do that again later. But speaking of sponsors, you know, we do want to thank people. People have been awesome. We've talked about it before. The people that have subscribed, the people that are watching. We talked about having 5 viewers as a goal. That's still my goal. So anything over that is a success. But you know, there's been a homie's been very generous. Shout out to him, Black Sheep and Haymaker. Tank has made contributions, Scotty B. And we have someone that is from the Well Nasty extended family, Scott Arnold, who was one of the founding members of Pony.
Yeah.
And I had a really long chat with him, like through text messages about the show. And this is really cool. And he's sponsoring an episode. This is probably his episode. So big thanks to you, Scott. It's awesome and very generous. Just he kind of had an outside perspective on Double Wide because he was around when it was starting. He played Flux in, I think, 01 and 02. And then he moved up to New York City. And
Flux was Double Wide's B team.
Yeah, was the B team. And he went up to New York, and there's some younger guys up there like him that didn't really love the old New York vibe.
Yeah.
Because it was just kind of like, win at all costs kind of thing.
And they had a reputation, I'm sure.
They had a reputation, and they wanted to do their own thing. And Scott came up with the name for Pony. He came up with the logo. And they've always had really cool gear. And, you know, when I'd see him at tournaments, it's always great running into him as a way that we kept in touch. And he just, you know, he commented that he saw our culture. Like, we had a really strong culture, you know, when I was playing. And I think it's one of the things that helped the team continues. Like, there's got to be a strong culture for a program to make it into 20 years of existence. So it was cool. I mean, and just sharing these stories and the history, and you hear from people, you have this common experience, but everyone has their own perspectives on what it meant to them.
Yeah.
Which I think is really cool.
Yeah. Thank you, Scott. Thanks for sharing that tidbit about Double Wide.
Yeah.
So awesome.
Yeah. And then I also want to talk a little about the show in general. The intro music, like you mentioned, I picked today's.
Yeah.
The other guests have picked the other music. We let the guests pick the intro music.
Yeah, I don't think we've ever said that out loud. Yeah. That's what's going on.
Do you remember what homie picked? What the band was?
Pantera.
You picked Pantera.
I did not pick Pantera.
You said Pantar.
Okay, I just said that.
That was the outro music.
Yeah, okay. What did he pick for intro?
Anthrax.
Okay.
And he didn't hesitate on that.
All right.
Tank had Beastie Boys,
yeah,
which is appropriate. And Max, I don't know, Max was from the 2012 dub mix.
Yeah. I forget the name of the song and the band, but it's a tight song.
But that was a big part of Seasons for a while, too.
The mixtape.
The mix.
Yeah.
Yeah, getting your song in the mix.
I spent so much time thinking about the songs that I would put on there, and I personally feel like the song I picked in 2013 is the reason we lost.
What was the song?
I actually spliced together. Yeah, I was super into like a Derrick Rose like highlight video, and there was a tight song on there, and then like I mixed it together with some other stuff, and then I was like so excited for everyone to hear it, and they're like, "What is this?" And I was like, "We're gonna lose," and we did, and it's my fault.
They weren't sharing your hype on it.
No,
that's too bad.
Mm-hmm.
Mine. We had one during a season one year. My song was Summer Breeze. Do you remember that?
Uh-uh.
Do you know the song?
No.
Summer breeze makes me feel fine.
I'm sure we did not win that year either.
Yeah, but we knew that going in, we were going to win that. But that just made everyone feel good.
Okay.
Stu's was Easy Like Sunday Morning.
That's a good one.
By the Commodores.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, fun. I do want to mention we're drinking out of full service pint glasses today.
Yeah, we got some feedback from the community. Specifically, was it Sam Murphy?
Sam Murphy.
Thank you for calling us out.
Yeah. He gave that feedback to Hogue, and then Hogue shared it.
Yeah.
Which just let you know, if you share it with anyone, that's not safe. We're going to find out.
Yeah, he was not He was not happy with you guys.
And it's understandable, too. I mean, we were drinking Guinness out of cans. You don't drink a Guinness out of a can. You drink it out of a pint glass. So it was the right thing to do. Thank you, Sam Murphy. Do you call him Smurf? Is that a nickname?
Smurf, yeah.
You call him Smurf. Thanks, Smurf.
He said, well, lad, hope you're doing good. Loving the Double Wide podcast. But for God's sake, someone get those men some pint glasses for their Guinness. Watching them drink the sweet nectar of the gods from a can is like making Walsh watch someone eat a chicken fried steak without gravy. It's inhumane.
Wow, it's like Sam's right here.
That is great feedback.
That is good.
Yeah. And we've also had some staples on the show. We tried to get some staples.
Stalling 10.
The who's on the line. Or what is it? On the line. And then we're going to have the sign off as well.
Yeah.
And Hoag, you always have to harmonize with us now on the sign off.
I'm here for you.
I appreciate it. Because you're really going to be the voice that carries us through that.
Thank you. And then in post, I'll just stack like high harmonies, mid harmonies, all that stuff.
Please.
And just because we don't have a guest tonight doesn't mean we're not doing Stalling 10.
Oh, let's go.
You were supposed to say Stalling 10.
Yeah, I'm a little rusty.
I'm going to have to do this whole thing.
Stalling 10.
All right, perfect.
Oh, what's your last question going to be?
Don't worry
about
it. You're
going to try to throw me off?
Yeah, I think you already know it. I think you already know what the question is.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
I'm not going to set a timer because I think everyone knows there's not really a timer. But Hoag will get the clock ticking in the background.
Okay.
But I've got five questions.
Okay, let's go.
And answer them as quickly as you can. Act like there is a 10-second timer.
I might take my time.
All right. Stalling 10. Are you ready?
I'm nervous. Okay. Yeah, let's go.
Okay. First question, paper or plastic?
Paper.
High socks or low socks?
High socks.
Three-quarter tights or full length?
Three-quarter tights.
Swag ball or cornhole?
Swag ball.
Double wide or chain?
Cue that music. Say it. Do it.
You played on chain.
Oh. Double wide.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well done.
Thank you. Wow. Now I know what it feels like to be doing a stalling 10.
How was it?
On the other end.
How was it?
It's amazing.
Do you want to explain every question that I asked you?
Yeah.
Paper or plastic? Why'd I ask that?
I don't know.
You work at HEB.
Okay, that's good. We don't even serve plastic bags. Come on.
And not in Austin, but you go outside Austin, there's people throwing plastic all over the place.
Oh, okay.
Maybe. I just said that for argument's sake.
Wait. Do you work at HEB?
Yeah.
Really?
Cheese aisle.
All right, forget it.
It's a high-tech cheese aisle.
I am a software engineer at HEB.
Hold on. What's the second question? High socks or low socks?
High socks.
Yeah. You ever wear low socks?
I got low socks on right now, actually. But not
when playing?
I used to, but once I like knew what the fuck was going on, it was high socks.
Okay. I almost followed up with black or white.
Mm.
What would you say, black or white socks?
Black.
Yeah. You know my feeling about white socks, right?
Yeah, you can't wear white socks with black cleats.
That's right. Okay. Or black shoes.
Yeah.
Ever.
Right.
Like no matter. I mean, I give kids a break. Like if someone's parents put them out for them and they put it on, I'll give a kid a benefit of a doubt, but not an adult.
Kids should know better.
They'll learn. Three-quarter tights or full length?
Three-quarter tights. I think you asked me that because I really pushed for getting three-quarter tights as like gear on the team.
Double Wide's getting mantis made with DWTX on it.
That's awesome. When I played Soul, they gave us Soul.
Yeah.
Well, mantis or tights?
Well, they're getting mantis.
Okay. Soul gave us three-quarter tights. That's sweet. Awesome.
What temperature triggers tights for you? 65 with, yeah. a little breeze. Yeah. Swag ball or cornhole?
Well, if there's a little breeze, I'm gonna come out with some warm-up pants on too and then take them off.
Some tearaways.
Yeah.
Swag ball or cornhole?
Oh, that was tough because I'm really good at both of them, but I've broken so many hearts with swag ball, so
yeah,
that's what I went with.
I'm really good at swag ball too.
Yeah, you're all right.
I'm pretty good. I once like got so bored out at the rugby fields because I kept winning. I couldn't even like enjoy the party.
Yeah, but I wasn't there. I've made money off swag ball. Okay. Like lots of money.
That's fair. And then we know the double wider chain.
Yeah.
Can you cue it up again?
Oh, fuck. Well, give me
no, just, we don't have time.
Just imitate it.
We don't have
you
time.
You played on chain.
Man, we were talking about it earlier. Homie tried to ambush me in episode one.
Yeah, I set him up for that. I had to find the time for the clip because I asked him. I was like, "When you were in Atlanta, did you ever consider playing for a team?" Other
you teed him up.
Yeah, and he did it. I love that clip.
Yeah,
but you did play on chain.
I did play on chain.
But you came back and won the championship with Dub.
Yes,
and that's all that matters.
I did. Oh man.
Oh, Sam is not gonna like that. Sam,
you're gonna need to watch this tablecloth.
Oh man.
Oh, Sam, God.
Sam, sorry.
For fuck's sake.
That was a good one.
Yeah, I played on chain. I think one thing I didn't explain in episode one, just since we're talking about it, I grew up in Austin, so I was ready to leave for a couple of years.
That was another consideration of a question.
Yeah.
A&M or UT?
Oh, man. Just coming out firing. Okay. I also went to A&M my freshman year. I guess I like to see both sides.
Yeah, that's fair.
Rivalry.
You're a diplomat.
I'm a diplomat. And one thing that we didn't talk about with Max is my roommate at A&M was a Frisbee player, and he did not even think to ask me to like come out and play Dozen Ultimate.
Yeah.
And I think that's what fueled me to try to be good, just to get back at them because they didn't ask me.
And let's talk about the name Dozen Ultimate for a second.
It's the worst name.
It's pretty bad. And for all you Aggie double wide guys out there, keep listening. Don't shut us down right now, but just
accept your name sucks.
Yeah, just listen to why I think it's a bad idea, and you can explain your side in the comments. So A&M's famous for the 12th man,
because
there's 11 players on a football team.
Yeah,
and then they have the 12th man, the guy that's like walk on.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Well, so they have the 12th man that plays. He wears number 12. Plus, they call their crowd like the 12th man because they're so loud.
That's
right.
That's I think right.
So. On a Frisbee field, there's 7 players on the team. And so it should be 8th
man.
I mean, what do you call like dozen? Like dozen is like bakery terms for 12. What's the bakery term for 8th thing?
I don't know.
So donut holes, I think they ultimate.
Yeah.
So
I'll look it up, but I don't think there is one.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
Octo ultimate. Go with that. Well, but it's established now. Thank you for participating in that. I know I kind of ambushed you again, but I wanted it to be a surprise.
Yeah.
The stalling 10. And I think you did a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I had time today to think about it because you were busy working and I was hanging out.
Yeah. HEB.com was on fire. Everybody wanted cheese and I had to help out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good job. So we wanted to address kind of episode by episode, some corrections. Actually, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. There's a couple more people I want to thank, or one more in particular, Matt Lane.
Yeah.
Former double wide player. He took a lot of really good ultimate pictures for a while.
Yeah.
And he's let us use some in these episodes, like some of the ones from Homie's episode, probably from Tank's and Max's as well. And one of the things we talked about, like, why are we hosting? We talked a little bit about it in the first episode, just kind of having an interest in it. But our relationship, like, I played, your first year was 2005.
Five.
And I played since 01. I'm like, I don't know how many years older than you. How old are you?
I'm 16.
Okay. So I'm about 30 years older than you.
Yeah.
But one of the ways we bonded was back when Google had GChat, and that was an amazing feature.
Yeah.
We had like really funny conversations on there, but also low budget photoshopping skills.
Mm-hmm.
And we will share some of those in the YouTube. I don't have them now. I can't. I'm not going to put them in front of the camera, but we'll send them to Hogue and get them put up there. But there's some good ones. My personal favorite of me is the one titled Sledgehammer Goatface.
Let's just leave it at that.
Yeah. And so maybe we'll put it at the end so people can appreciate some of the ways that we got to know each other and whatever. But yeah, those photos came from Matt.
Yeah.
And actually, I have, Crystal bought me one of those. There's a framed picture of that in my garage.
Yeah, it's so good.
Not the Sledgehammer goat face, but the original picture of it.
Oh, I thought it was a Sledgehammer. I thought you framed that.
No, maybe in a cheap frame.
Yeah, you did.
But Crystal gave it to me as like a Christmas gift one year. She she gave it to me. Okay. All right, so I think we're ready to get into the like talking about some of the things we might have missed or corrections we needed to make from our first episode.
Yeah, let's get into it.
So obviously, Homie was episode one.
Yeah.
There was some confusion about the legend, the man, Don Tom.
Yeah.
And whether or not he played at Rice Ultimate.
Yeah.
And Molly really got on his ass about it.
Got on Homie's ass?
Well, actually, no. Molly said something to Crystal, and Crystal said something to me. She's like, Don didn't play at Rice. He played at Carlton.
Yeah.
But Homie had said he played at Rice, but Don never went to Rice.
Yeah.
So there was this confusion, and I finally asked him about it. Don Tom went to Carlton, Ultimate Frisbee.
For undergrad.
For undergrad. Ultimate Frisbee superpower, right?
Yeah.
Really good program. And then he moved to Houston, and he was like pursuing his professional life, and he thought he was done playing. But a guy that was mentioned in another episode, Emeka, was friends with him, and he pulled him in, and he played with Rice in the open season. So when they're competing against club teams, not against college teams.
Yeah.
So he played with Rice at sectionals and regionals, and he helped Rice qualify for their first regionals as a college team playing in the open division.
Yeah.
But he never enrolled at Rice and didn't play with them in the college season. So
mystery solved.
It's complicated, but that is the mystery solved. The legend of Don Tom.
Mystery corrected.
Yeah. But just think, Don was done.
That is wild to me because, I mean, you know, looking at the course of his career, he's still playing.
He's still playing.
Such a successful career, and so many people remember him for all sorts of like really positive reasons. So
yeah,
it would have been crazy if he would have just never played.
Yeah, really. I mean, 1993, just think if he had stopped 28 years ago.
I wasn't even born then.
Tank. Never would have found Tank laughing in the back of the stack. Another one from that, when we had that perfect phone call.
Yeah.
With John
Hammond,
the kid. He was talking about the powder keg of a game with the two Florida teams.
Oh, yeah.
Playing for that third bid to Nationals.
Yep.
And he thought perhaps it was Stevie Franchise Presley that threw a beer bottle onto the field during the game that almost set off a riot.
I may have suggested that, but regardless of who said it, yeah, in that episode, we were like, yeah, it was Stevie.
Yeah. And I got feedback from listener Roscoe Dick, double wide legend, Ross Dick.
Yeah.
And he said it was not Stevie. It was, in fact,
Catherine Wooten. Which is really funny because I became pretty good friends with her when I played on Chain. And I don't think I ever asked her about it.
You played on Chain?
But Stevie, your name is cleared.
Yeah, you're good. Yeah. There's some other stuff that happened that day, but as far as the bottle throwing, you're definitely in the clear.
Mystery corrected.
Yes. And then the other one, this one is a little extensive, and this gets into kind of double wide's historical context nationally since its inception in 2001. One kind of weird thing. We talked about, like, Homie talked about Hounds playing at Worlds in 1993 in Madison. But then they didn't qualify for Nationals until 1997.
Yeah, that was... Okay.
And so... This is kind of funny. I talked to Shawnee Mack. Sean McCall, longtime double wide player. He had the same span of double wide I did. And he's another guy that's still playing. He told me there is a Hounds captain at the time that basically wrote a letter to WFDF telling them that there needed to be another, like a Southern team at Worlds. And WFDF accepted that. And the Hounds played at Worlds.
That's so
without
awesome.
Having to qualify for it. They just wrote a letter and WFDF is like, yeah, come on. Come play.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
Why didn't we ever think of that? We should have just not gone to sectionals and regionals and just wrote a letter and been like, we want to go to nationals.
Yeah. We noticed your tournament's missing a team from Austin, Texas. We just think we should be there. And yeah. They might have been like, sure, come on.
Let's try it.
Yeah. Yeah, for next one. When is the next one?
I have no idea, but
it's worth a shot.
I just want to write some letters now. Just see what I mean. We don't even know what we could get. We could try. We could get so many things.
The pen is mightier than the sword.
Ooh.
So they say.
Yeah.
I could look up this guy's name.
Ernest Hemingway.
Scott Buchanan. This is a
Scott
Dallas
name
guy.
Is really familiar.
He was in Dallas. That must have been a Houston Dallas combo team for Worlds. So here's some stats, because I looked up what happened at that Worlds in Madison.
Okay.
There were 18 U.S. teams.
18?
18 U.S. teams out of 44 total open teams at the tournament in Madison, Wisconsin in July of 1993. The Alvin Hounds finished 10th. The worst U.S. finish was 22nd place by Panic. So 18 of the top 22 teams were U.S.
Man.
Sockeye finished 11th.
Yeah.
So the Hounds are better than Sockeye. So take that, Sockeye. So the Hounds did not make nationals until 1997.
They didn't write any more letters.
They wrote no more letters. They couldn't get into nationals. They couldn't get by Chain.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Because you were talking about in the episode, you're like, hey, there's a lot of pressure when you play on a team that made Worlds, mm-hmm. right? No pressure, apparently.
There's no pressure. If you make Worlds because you got it because of a letter, there's no pressure.
There's no pressure at
you're
all.
You're like, what, you're going to run out of ink?
Yeah.
Can't write any more letters? Like, this is going to be fine.
Hey, guys, we're short on stamps. We need a fucking fundraiser to get this letter off to Sweden or whatever WFDF is based. So, the Hounds did not make nationals until 1997. They finished tied for 13th, which was last place because there's only 14 teams, right? If you're tied for 13th out of 14, you're last, right? You just didn't play it out. In 1998, they finished tied for 5th with Furious George. So it makes it sound like they played, you know, they lost quarters, then they played, and then didn't play against Furious. Parking Lot Jam, who later became Jam, finished tied for 7th with Sub-Zero in 98. In 1999, the Hounds were tied for 5th again. They made quarters along with Ring and Jam and some other team called Blaze of Glory. In 2000, I was going to say like another number, so I said 2000 word. I was going to say 2001, but I said in 2000, the Hounds finished 15.
Episode 4, ladies and gentlemen, this content.
Only ahead of Blackjack. The Hounds finished ahead of Blackjack. You ever heard of them?
No.
No.
Write me a letter.
Yeah. I don't
know
who that is.
Write us a letter, Blackjack.
And that is it.
We might, oh, write us a letter if you want to be on the show.
Yeah.
And we might open it.
If you want to play on Worlds and be on the show,
yeah.
Send a letter.
Yeah.
And then that's it. The Hounds are done.
Wow. Woof.
So. Say it again.
No.
Okay. There's more. Like Shawnee Mac can expand on this.
Yeah.
I talked to him about it. They were close. They were close to making semis the year.
At Nationals.
They were really close when they ended up in 99. And then they lost some guys.
Wow.
And then some people left. And then they had a 15th place finish in 2000. And then Double Y came on the next year.
That's crazy. I mean, there's so many. And making semis, I think, is such a... achievement or like what a lot of teams want, and yeah, I think that must have been a weird feeling for those Hounds guys to like get so close and then
have it fall apart.
Yeah, I wasn't gonna say fall apart. I mean, yeah, just like the team transitions into something else, and yeah. You just kind of like wonder.
So look, Double Wide comes along the next year, so
2001.
Double Wide now has 17 national championship tournament appearances.
Wow.
Since Double Wide was founded in 2001, that is the fourth most appearances in that span. Can you name the other three teams, the three teams that would be ahead of Double Wide with national
appearances
since that time. If you're listening, you can hit pause if you want to think about it for 5 seconds.
Oh, I thought you were asking me.
I am.
Oh.
But okay. I'm also making a suggestion to America. Like, if they don't want to hear you, you know, if they just, they need some think time.
Okay.
But you can answer because they're on pause now.
All right. So, I think Sockeye.
Ding.
2001. Rhino.
No.
Fuck.
No.
Chain.
No.
Boston. Well, no, Boston doesn't count.
So you have to have consistent name.
Consistent.
So that's part of this too. Yeah.
It's God, I thought I knew stuff about Frisbee.
I'll tell you.
No.
Got to think regions where it'd be easier to qualify.
Rain.
No.
God.
Oh yes.
Yeah.
And yeah, my bad. Yes, ring. Ring is one.
I can't believe I said Rhino. I can't think of the third one.
Johnny Bravo.
Huh.
So, I've got the chart.
Kiran, what the fuck, man? I'm in here. I got all those.
You did?
Yes.
Why did you say something?
Because I wanted to give you a chance.
Oh. Well, it's easy to say that after the fact. Come in here where it's hot.
Yeah.
It's nice and cool in that studio.
It is hot in here.
You got that computer, too. I see it. Okay, so let me reflect on that. Sokka, I think, is obvious. Johnny Bravo, not so obvious to me, but I guess, like, your clue about regions.
Yeah. Because it was just them and Condors for a while.
Yeah,
and then
Southwest.
The occasional PBR streak game. Which is another bad
But they've been around forever, and they're pretty consistent.
Yeah.
And then Ring... they've been around forever too.
Yeah. So look, so Ring of Fire and Johnny Bravo have qualified every year.
Really?
Yeah. Sockeye's made it 18 times. I think they missed in like 2016. I'm not sure what happened there. And then Double Wide, we missed in 02 and 06. So here's a quick note on some other teams that have been around for a long time.
Okay.
Condors started in 74.
Yeah.
But didn't start playing against opponents until 1976.
What were they doing?
I don't know. I don't know if they had a
How
name.
How can you be a team?
Because they're just a group of guys that hung out, I guess. It didn't say that on their website. it didn't provide that much detail.
Okay.
But that's what it said.
Okay.
But they could have played against each other. I don't know if they were like had a name or doing cheers, and they went back later and said like, okay, we started in 1974.
We should, we could do like an on the line with Greg Hollywood Husak and get to the bottom. I'm curious about that. How can you be a team if you don't play other people?
He was... Two.
No, but he's gonna know. He'll know about the history. Are we called Steve Dugan?
Yeah. Okay.
He Fine. Was like 50 when
he started the Masters Division.
Yeah.
Chain has been around since 1981.
Okay, but just didn't make nationals enough. Because they were Atlas.
Oh, so right, but they fell off in the last 5 or 6 years mm-hmm. with the new system of qualifying for nationals.
Yeah.
So
they lost a lot of good players.
Yeah.
You played on
Chain? Yeah. So, but, I mean, they've been around since 81, but my stat was only from 2001.
Okay.
Then Ring of Fire has been around since 1989.
Yeah.
Sockeye has been around since 1990.
Yeah.
They have on their website historical rosters.
Yeah, get to it.
It goes back to 1995, where you can find Calvin Lin on the roster of Sockeye.
Calvin's been mentioned, I think, in every episode.
Has he? Possible.
Well, we'll have to do episode 5 and do a correction on that. Not sure.
Yeah.
I feel like he has been talked about a lot.
Yeah. Rhino Slam since 1990.
That's why I said their name.
Furious George since 1995. Johnny Bravo since 1996, Sub-Zero since 97, and then Dub since 2001. So some of that, like, Boston has been every year, but they were Dog, and then they were Boston Ultimate, and then they were Ironside.
Yeah.
Chain 1 year, they were Atlas, but they didn't qualify anyway because they lost to Double Wide.
Hey.
And that's really it for episode 1. I do have some cool things to look at. I made a chart. Charts are nice.
Yeah.
Do you want to see the chart?
Yeah.
I've got this thing. one that shows like the Southern team's results at Nationals and from 81 through 2019. 2020, there was no Nationals because of COVID. Yeah, the Nationals appearance. I did a lot of clicking through
I put in every team.
Yeah. I put in every team that made it. Like, in Big Ass Truck made Nationals 5 times. And I have an idea on names. Like, if you want a name to stick, you don't have the name Ass in it. Because there is some team from the South called, where is it?
Ass Man?
No, Fat Women. There was a team that made Nationals from the South in 1983 and 1984 called Fat Women.
Well, like, you're also really handicapping yourself in terms of letter writing because nobody's going to let you into Worlds with a Fat Women team name.
Yeah, Hounds with a Z. Like, that Z gives you a little bit of an edge.
Yeah, yeah.
But Fat Women.
No.
No, come on.
Throw the letter away.
Come on, guys. So it just goes down through there. And then the Nationals appearance, the chart. I'm proud of that chart.
That's a good chart.
It's a good chart. And then the red line is championship. So Revolver's been...
I'm just laughing because, well, I guess personal note, KG's son likes to do stuff like this. I know where he gets it from. But KG's son, who's his name? What's his name?
Kiran Thomas.
Yeah. That's true, ladies and gentlemen. His name is Kiran Thomas Gaffney. Anyways... Kiran would have the team names would be in their team colors.
That's true. He would have stepped it up a little bit as far as presentation.
That's okay.
But Revolver has been 13 times. They've made the most of their appearances. They've won 5 times.
Good for them.
Pretty good. Sockeye's won 4 times. Furious 3. Then a lot of ones, really.
Yeah.
Bravo once. Double Wide once, Chain once, Condors once since 2001.
Yeah, they've won more than that.
Ironside, Pony, and Jam.
Pre-2001.
And Pony got theirs. So.
Man, it was so awesome when Jam won.
That was a good game.
Yeah. And, I mean, those guys were just so cool. That was awesome.
So that's episode one, corrections. Episode two.
Michael Tank Natenberg's episode.
Tank Natenberg, the most viewed episode. I think we had.
Sorry, Hobie.
Sorry, Max.
Sorry, Max. Sorry, episode 4.
Tank's got lost away. I think so. Here's my theory on the views for Max's episode dropping. You want to hear my theory?
Yeah.
I think at this point people are having watch parties.
Yeah.
So one viewer represents like five.
It's 10 eyeballs.
Yeah. So it's actually like 1,000 views,
but 2,000 eyeballs.
People were just hanging out, watching it together, laughing and having a great time. Episode 2. Here's the big miss on Tank's episode.
Yeah.
There's a lot to talk about with Tank. We spent way more time explaining his nickname to him than I thought we would.
Well, it was confusing that we had to explain a lot of things to him about himself. But I think the big thing to miss, I mean, that's confusing. The big thing is because, and I say this genuinely, we didn't talk about his spirit timeout that he called against Furious George. And when I say when I'm talking about being genuine, like, I think that defined a lot of his character.
Yes.
And like, it's funny to talk about, but it's also like, I don't know many people that could have pulled that off.
That's the only person, I think.
On Double Wide, for sure.
Yeah.
And he had really good intentions and he pulled it off. I mean, so you want to fill in some of the details on what actually happened?
Yeah. Well, spirit was very important to Tank.
Yeah.
Not so important to me. Like,
I think you made that pretty clear over the course of your career.
Well, I just think, I mean, here's an honest take on it. Like, and I think it's just good sportsmanship. And I think there's kind of a unique talking about it and ultimate how it's the spirit of the game and how you have, like, it's not reffed, but it's like you go play pickup basketball. There's no ref and people are calling their own fouls. You're just not flying to another city to play pickup basketball and not call your own fouls.
I get where you're going, but pickup basketball, you will see the worst of the worst in terms of humanity. I don't think that happens as much in Frisbee because there's...
Right. I think, but like as a guiding principle for the sport, I think it's great. Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's great. But I do think when you get pushed to the highest levels of the sport, that it would get violated. And then there is no repercussion for violating the spirit and like really important games when you got dudes dropping a lot of time and dollars to get places.
Sure.
So I always had like my kind of poor spirit at times, I think came from some of the early good teams that I played where I like got bad feel from Condors and Dog.
And you just felt like you're getting taken advantage of.
Like taking advantage of the rules and just like unwillingness and like sideline aggression and stuff like that. And I didn't always feel like our team was ready to handle that stuff. And we get kind of floored by it sometimes at tournaments. And I was like, what the fuck is this? Like, talk about the spirit of the game, like it's founding principle. But then you come here and these are the best teams and they're not exhibiting it. And it wasn't really until I like played with some other guys, like Damian Scott was an amazing player.
Yeah. And very spirited.
Very spirited.
Yeah.
Like you would, he'd be more likely to yell at his own teammates than he would be at a guy on another team. Like he was able to resolve things. He's also great and probably, you know, didn't matter if you fouled him because he could just break you every which way.
Considered one of the best, if not best player in the world during his peak. Yeah. So, but your point is like until you saw somebody like that so good, you were like, oh, it can be done this way.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Tank, very spirited, great player.
Yeah.
We were playing at Santa Cruz, Labor Day tournament.
Yeah.
Which is like the big last tournament before you go into sectionals and regionals back in the old style of qualifying for nationals prior to, I think it changed in 2013.
Yeah.
Right, where they had the flights and stuff like that. So great tournament to go to, really high competition because there's a lot of talent on the West Coast and you'd get, you know, we'd go out there and then you'd get teams coming in from, you know, Boston would go out there a lot as well.
Furious would go there.
Furious was there. And we're playing against Furious. And it's 2009. And the game was just heated. I remember a couple of key moments. Jake Anderson was playing double wide at the time. Someone put a disc up to him deep. He was being guarded by Andrew Lugsden, also known as Luggy. He's a Hall of Famer. Great player for a really long time for Furious. Jake went up and kind of had to reach back because the disc floated. Luggy ran into him, kind of got his legs out from under him. Jake hit hard, called a foul. Luggy contested, saying that Jake went backwards and that he had his right to his forward motion. Yeah. This is like classic to me, like shitty kind of spirit.
So setting up a contentious environment.
And so I texted some guys. I'll name drop some dead buds. Like Terry and Jeff. And
Terry
Max.
Youngman, Jeff Losborn. Yeah.
I texted Scott. He wasn't there. But people remembering that game, Terry was saying, like, people are basically tackling each other. Like, it just got really physical. And I think it'd be a thing where, like, people would foul and just be like, contest. Right? And it's just getting kind of ugly. And I don't know what the straw that broke the camel's back. But Matthew Clark, who I also texted, at some point spiked a Furious George player's hat. I don't know if he had scored on him or what happened, but he took the guy's hat and spiked it.
Maybe breaking the camel's back at that moment.
Yeah, and Tank, I don't know if it was a whoa, 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 whoa. We're like, hey, hey, hey. And Tank managed to call a spirit timeout and get 40 guys
adult
together.
People.
Yeah.
Men.
Like down at one end of the field. And lecture everybody on what it meant to play the game and how what we were doing was against like the founding, like the.
Is that what he said? I honestly can't remember what he said. I just remember thinking, I can't believe that we're all that. Not that I wanted to leave that situation, but that we were. Like the other team was actually staying there. Like they didn't have to stay there.
Yeah. They didn't know him. Like
they were listening to him.
Yeah. And I don't know if we went like every other. I don't think we did that. If it was like Furious Double Wide, Furious Double Wide.
No.
But so, I mean, the game cleaned up after that.
Yeah.
Furious as a program never recovered.
Right. If you want to end a team, call spirit timeout with them in the middle of the game. They will never know.
They will not know what to do.
And we won the game.
We won the game. Furious was never the same.
Yeah.
If you picture a field being like 120 yards long, we're down like, you know, close to the end zone, to one of the end zones. On the other end zone stood one player. What was that player's name?
I think we should ask the audience to pause and think about who would it be.
Who would it be in 2009? One double wide player standing alone away from the spirit circle. Mm-hmm. Ponder that for 5 seconds. And that's fine. You didn't have to participate.
Yeah.
He chose not to, and I'm surprised all the Furious guys did, but yeah, we beat them. We had a decent tournament and Furious shambles. That's why they don't have as many nationals appearances as Double Wide.
Yeah.
But that was a seminal tank moment.
Yeah, and again, like I think something that we kind of poke fun at, but it's also like, wow, like mad, like respect. Like I respect him so much for doing that because they believed in it so much. Yeah. And like to kind of just go out on a limb and make that happen.
Because he saw incredible. Things as like falling apart. I saw things like as
humanity.
Like
humanity
as just getting amped up. Like I was like ready. Like every time there's two guys I'm furious and I was like yelling at the whole time and they're yelling at me. And I was like thinking of my next insult for like when we scored. And then Tank is like, whoa, 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 whoa. It's like, damn it, Tank. I had a good one about riding coattails and not being good anymore. I have to fucking save that for my podcast in 12 years. Do you want to know what my insult to them was?
Yes.
Because I remember it. I was going to say that I rode Mike Grant's coattails to some MAGA championships as well.
Oh, my God.
That would have been a good one.
Oh, my God, Canada.
Yeah. Canada's not listening. We've never addressed Canada.
Oh, my God, Canada and America.
Yeah. Oh, my God, North America.
Yeah. North America. Are you listening? Forget about you, Mexico.
Yeah. Those guys were like, what is he talking about? Are we allowed to make fun of Canada like that? Is that still okay?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's still fair game?
Yeah.
Okay.
There are some nice guys in Canada.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel conflicted because I did this whole thing with BE Ultimate, their Canada-based company, so I don't want to like trash the whole thing. Okay. Like, I worked with some really cool guys.
I played with a Canadian team at 2002 Worlds in Hawaii.
Are you serious?
From Calgary. Sean and I did. He got
the
team.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
We got last place in spirit.
That's good. Well, I mean, that makes sense. Canada, they always suck in spirit. Except for BE Ultimate. Yeah. You guys.
Thank you.
Great guys. Hoke just told me that I could take this microphone off of the stand. And wow.
How did that feel?
It felt amazing.
All right.
Also, we were hoping this would be a 1-hour episode, but I'm pretty sure it's turning into
here's the deal.
3-hour ordeal.
I think you started episode 2 corrections when there was 10 minutes left.
Yeah, let's speed it
well,
up.
Well, there's not much to episode 3. We're solid in episode 3.
No, but just, you know.
We'll do our thing. So, good job, Tank. You killed Furious George.
Yeah, good job. Again, I didn't know you could do Call of Spirit timeout like that. It just really opened up my mind.
Yeah. So, that was a big miss. So, there's that correction. Sorry. Episode 3, we were pretty solid.
Episode 3, Max Cook.
Max Cook. There were a couple things that we failed to mention. One of them actually brought up to me by Scott Arnold. He's like, how could you not mention the length of Max's shorts when he played Ultimate? We spent a lot of
time.
They're
really long.
Yeah.
Really big shorts.
Hogue said like Fab Five era style.
And is I don't even more, think it does it justice.
Do you remember there's this shot of TJ Ford, his rookie year picture with the Milwaukee Bucks.
I kind of remember this.
They're barely above his socks.
Yeah.
They're like down to mid chin. And Max was there. Like he'd get, I think, a medium in the shirts and a double XL in the shorts.
Yeah.
So that was one thing. That was a unique style he had.
Mystery corrected.
Another double Y player, K Rich, he wore big shorts for a while.
Yeah, but he's tall.
He is tall, but his shorts also went like far.
Yeah. All the UNT guys, him, Jake, Matt Radnall.
Yeah. They have big shorts. And then the other one, like just a small thing with Max that we didn't mention, he played his last like 4 years of double wide as he's a dad.
Yeah.
Which is a rare thing in like high level ultimate. I mean, you know, obviously there's masters, grandmasters, super, super, super grandmasters guys that are dads, but Max, when you won the championship in 2012, Emery was like 6 months old, something like that. And that's like, at the time, if you're not a dad and he's doing that, you're like, cool. But once you are a dad, you're like, God, that's fucking crazy. Like,
yeah.
How did you keep it together? How did you get the okay? How did you do the whole thing?
I mean, and in addition to all of that, like being a player on the team, I remember somebody was like, this guy, Max is like coming in, because Max's personality and his approach to the team is so committed. He does everything.
Right.
Like he's not going to miss a practice. He's going to do every track workout. And so there was no excuse. So you're like, this guy has a kid and he's waking up and he's coming to every practice and he's doing all the things, he's communicating. So it was kind of crazy in a way that I think it was motivating and a motivational tool for the rest of the team. Is just like, if he's doing all these things, you can do it too.
Yeah.
So that was really interesting.
Our corrections list got shorter and shorter.
I think we just got better and better.
Yeah. We did it. That's actually it for corrections.
You should make a chart about, oh look at that.
We ran out of money.
That's the sound.
The screen goes black.
We're going to turn off the lights. We don't have money to pay for electricity.
Shut it down.
What else are we doing?
That was it.
That's the end of the episode?
But, I mean, we can wrap it up.
Oh, okay. What do you want to talk about?
Does it feel anticlimactic?
No.
Okay.
I'm still climactic.
Well, so yeah, we got better. I mean, the hounds thing was a long thing. The tank thing was the second craziest thing that ever happened to me at a Santa Cruz.
The timeout. I personally think Furious was just shocked that that was happening.
Yeah.
But the end result was maybe some self-reflection on their end, just being like, we're taking it too far. Double wide's taking it too far. Let's bring it back.
So it did work.
Yeah.
We won and they are no longer a team anymore.
I don't know how we like departed that circle.
Yeah.
Like,
how do we even know which? Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. Like, we must have finished. I know we won the game.
We won the game, but I wonder like how he ended and he's like ultimate on three.
Oh yeah, how do you walk away?
Yeah, how
from
do you
that?
Walk away from that?
Yeah, because like we harmonize when we end the episode. Yeah. It's like there's like an awkward silence. Like, well, see you on the field.
Next point. Yeah, I don't know. I'd like to see that.
Okay. I want to do a who's popping in the zone after hours.
You want to try it out right now?
Yeah. I think it was that tournament too, man. What 2009 was a crazy year. You and I were hanging out Labor Day. Everyone used to go to that tournament because it's 3-day weekend.
Yes,
and
I know where you're going.
It's only 2-day tournament, so everyone had Monday off because it's Labor Day. So everyone partied together. All the teams partied together.
Right.
Everyone went to the same bar on Sunday, and it was just a good way. I think all the teams. It was like a good way to just take a break from like the stress of the season and just hang out and just party before you like get into the stretch run for nationals where right. you're like really going after it. Okay. So that's all to say everyone's getting really drunk.
Right.
Not me though.
Nope.
Cause
not
I'm
you.
Responsible.
That's right. Me too. Cause I teach eighth grade science.
So we are hanging out, at that bar. Should I do this?
Go ahead.
Get it after hours. And we're talking to like, players from other teams, you know, like great playing. I always like blah blah blah. I thought you really good at this, blah blah, blah, saying stuff back.
Yeah.
And then I'm not gonna name names.
No, you don't. You shouldn't.
But I'll name teams.
Go ahead.
We're talking to a guy from Sockeye. We're talking to a guy from Sockeye.
Yes.
And a Johnny Bravo guy comes up.
Correct.
And he, I don't even know how we did this, but he ended up. I'm just going to go for it. He just ended up dumping a pitcher of pee on the Sockeye guy's head.
The liquid was clear at this point.
But the Sockeye guy didn't know.
No.
But how did we know that was pee?
Because the Sockeye guy left and then the Johnny Bravo guy told us it was pee. And we were just like, oh my God.
Oh.
Yeah.
And thus concludes the first. if you have questions about that,
yeah. If you want, if you want names,
send us a letter.
Well, yeah, write a letter. We will tell you names.
But that is a true story. Like, I really didn't embellish any details. There, I mean, there's nothing to embellish. That's pretty objectively what happened.
We just kind of happened upon it.
Yeah. I mean, we were talking, we were in a conversation with the sockeye guy.
We didn't know what was in the picture.
No, 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 no. We had nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
I was like, whoa, that, I don't even remember like thinking, should I have called a spirit time out? Like, but when he dubbed that picture, because at that point I just thought it was water or beer. And I don't even remember the sockeye guy's reaction.
He was very...
He was annoyed?
No, he was really drunk. I think he just laughed it off and left.
I hope he showered before he got to bed.
He maybe.
Okay, but I think that's the end of that episode. But, you know, I always like to leave those kind of segments with some lessons. So the lesson here is don't pour a pitcher of pee on anybody ever.
Yeah, it's not cool.
No.
It's bad karma.
Not good.
Yeah. Is that the kind of person you want to be?
Not me.
No, me neither. Not even not even back then.
Yeah.
So we have more episodes coming up. We will have more guests.
Yeah.
We've got the next one lined up. Yeah. It might take a little while to happen.
Yeah.
Give you plenty of time to digest this episode.
My Invisalign might be off by then.
Dang.
Yeah, 2 years.
You look great. You're going to look great. Yeah. I might get some.
Invisalign, sponsor us.
Yeah. We're going to leave you with some of our low-budget Photoshoppings,
mm-hmm.
some outro music.
Mm-hmm.
But before we do that, we have to harmonize. Do you want me to start?
Yeah.
Well
nasty.
Nope.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, cut that.
Should we do it again?
No, let's just do it. Let's just have that.
Leave it.
Yeah, leave it.
Perfect.